How can we compute a singular value decomposition of a matrix A? The calculation is similar to the calculation of a diagonalization, but slightly more complicated. In this video, you will learn the construction, and you will also learn why this construction actually works. So, we want to decompose A as U times sigma times V transpose. And we denote sigma 1 up till sigma R as the first non-zero singular values of the matrix A. Well, A is m times n, so A transpose times A will be n times n, so you will have n singular values, but some of them may be zero. So we take only the first R, so R is smaller than n, smaller or equal, and those are the singular values we are going to use. Okay? And then we want to find the matrix U, m times n and orthogonal, and the matrix V, n times n and orthogonal. Those are surprisingly easy. Let's focus on the sigma part first. Well, the sigma matrix has a following form. It has to become an m times n matrix. So what do you do? You form a diagonal block where you put all your singular values. So an R times R diagonal block. Here, R times R. And then, in order to get an m times n matrix, you add 0. So you get n minus r columns of zeros over there. And here below, you also add 0. So you get m minus r rows of zeros below. So you have a diagonal block in your sigma matrix, and blocks of zeros, and blocks of zeros. So also a lot of zeros. Now, first, how do we compute U, sigma, and V? And then, the second part of this presentation, we'll see why this actually works. So let's take a look at some sigma matrices. For example, if you have a matrix A1, a 3 by 2 matrix, and we find, for example, the singular values 2 and 1, then what do we get for our sigma matrix? We get our diagonal block. With the 2 and the 1. And then we have to make it 3 by 2, so we need to add a row of zeros, and there we have our sigma 1. Or suppose we have some 2 by 3 matrix A, we compute the singular values, we get sigma 1, 3, then 2, and then 0. Now we only use the 3 and the 2, so put those in our diagonal block. And now we need a column of zeros over there to get the correct dimensions of the matrix. So that's how you find your sigma matrix, compute your singular values, only take the non-zero ones, put them in the diagonal, and just add some zeros to get the correct dimension for your matrix sigma. So there's the plan. What are the steps? Step 1, compute A transpose times A. Well, that's easy. And then you have to compute all eigenvalues, lambda 1 up to lambda n. Those will all be positive. And find an orthonormal basis of eigenvectors. So v1 up to vn will have to be an orthonormal basis of eigenvectors. You can always do that. If your eigenvectors are not orthogonal, you can use Gram-Schmidt and normalize on the last step. So this is quite some work here, step 2. And there you have already your matrix V. Just put V1 up to Vn as columns in your matrix. There you have your V. And we also have already our sigma. You have your lambda 1 up to lambda n. Take the first R non-zero eigenvalues. Take the square roots. There you have your diagonal part over here. And then just add all the zeros you need in order to get an m times n matrix sigma. That's step 4. So main computational part is here, step 2. Then we still need to find our matrix U. So what are we going to do? Well, we compute our UI as follows. We'll see later on why it works like this. Compute A times VI for I equals 1 up till R. So for all your non-zero eigenvalues, you compute A times VI. And then you divide by sigma I. And there you have your UI. Well, then you have only R vectors. We are going to put them in the matrix U, but we need M vectors. We need an orthonormal basis of Rm. So what are we going to do? We add m minus r vectors to those r vectors we already have, use Gram-Schmidt to form an orthogonal basis first, and then normalize, and then you have an orthonormal basis. So quite some work here as well. But then you're done, you just put everything in the matrix, and there you have your matrix U. Okay, here you have the construction, so this is what you have to do, those seven steps over there. But you might wonder, why does it work? So what are the critical steps? Well, you need to have two things. First of all, why is this U1 up to UR an orthonormal set? Okay, you're going to add vectors, but you make sure using Gram-Schmidt that you still keep an orthonormal set, so that will be okay. A matrix V was already orthogonal by construction, so that one is fine. But you still need to check, why do we have A times V equals U times sigma? That's also not so clear. Actually, the first question also already takes some effort, so let's take a look. Let's see how did we define U1, etc. If we want an orthonormal set, this inner product here, Ui inner product Uj, has to be equal to 0 if I is not equal to j, because then they are orthogonal. And if I equals j, then it has to be equal to 1, because it has to be normalized. So let us compute this inner product. Well, remember the definition. Ui was 1 over sigma I times A times Vi. So there you go. And you do the same for Uj over there. Then same trick for the inner product. Inner product between two vectors, take the transpose of the first times the second one. So that's what we do over here. And there you see, there we have it again. A transpose times A times Vj. But Vj was an eigenvector of the matrix A transpose times A. So A transpose times A times Vj equals lambda j times Vj. So, and then we do the same trick again. Vi transpose times Vj is the inner product Vi, inner product Vj. But now we use that we have an orthonormal basis. So Vi inner product Vj is equal to 0 if I is not equal to j, and 1 if I is equal to j, often denoted by this delta. And now we are happy, because our Ui inner product Uj, if this I is not equal to j, your delta is 0. So for I is not equal to j, you have a 0 over there. And if I is equal to j, then you are left with this prefactor. Well, the prefactor is lambda j divided by sigma I sigma j. But if I is equal to j, sigma I equals sigma j. So you get lambda j divided by sigma j squared. But sigma j was the square root of lambda j, so the sigma j squared equals lambda j. So this quotient becomes 1. So if I equals j, we get 1. So we can summarize this as Ui inner product Uj equals indeed delta ij. So 0 if I is not equal to j, 1 if I equals j. So there we have shown that we have indeed an orthonormal basis if we construct our Uis like this. And that proves the first step. Then the second one, we have to show that A times V equals U times sigma, so we compute A times V first and U times sigma next. Well, remember, for I between 1 and R, we defined Ui as AVI over sigma I, so A times VI equals sigma I Ui. And if I is bigger than R, all the remaining eigenvalues are 0. So the norm of A times Vi is 0, so A times Vi equals 0 in that case. And that allows us to compute A times V easily. A times V equals A times matrix with columns V1 up to Vn. So you get a matrix with AV1, AV2, AV3, etc. AV1 equals sigma 1 U1, AV2 equals sigma 2 U2, and so on, until the Rth one, where you get A times Vr equals sigma R times Ur. And then the remaining ones are zero, yield zero columns due to this condition over there. So there we have our A times V matrix with column sigma 1 u1 up to sigma r ur and then zero columns. Now continue with u times sigma. Here we have our u and there we have our sigma. We use the a column row rule to compute this product. So how do we do this? We take the first column here times the first column there. That will give us some matrix. Plus the second column here times the second column there. Give us some matrix. Until the rth column here times the rth column there. That will give us this product over here. And then we continue until we have the last column here, the mth column here, times the mth row over there, which is a bit boring because this will give you the um times matrix with only zeros. And then you can use your favorite way to compute these products over here, but you end up with a matrix with only one non-zero column, sigma 1 u1 and zeros, and then a matrix with this one, for example, all zero columns except for the rth one, which will give you a sigma r times ur. And if you add everything up, you get a matrix with columns sigma 1 u1, sigma 2 u2, up to sigma 3 u3, and zero columns. So that's what you get if you compute u times sigma, and you recognize, hey, that's exactly the same as what we had here for A times V. So indeed, if we construct our V and u and sigma like this, we indeed get A times V equals u times sigma, and we have the required orthogonal matrices u and v.